But yeah, at one point in life, I'll say it, I was nasty.
Okay.
I'll say it, I'll say it.
He said, I was nasty.
Yeah, your boy got that slide work, you know?
Got it. I'm not gonna lie to you, I was like, I feel like that nasty is a good thing, the way he's saying it, but I don't,
yeah.
I'm not good with some terms.
Welcome to Up, Up, Down, Down. I'm your host, Austin Creed, and today on Superstar Save Point, we got Rue Rue.
Hi, guys.
What's going on?
How are you?
I am fantastic. I'm happy to have you on. I feel like when we saw each other at TV a little while ago, we hadn't seen each other in so long. I was just so happy to see you.
Forever. Oh my goodness. My heart was so full that day. My heart was so full that I got to see you. But then the next week we were at Raw as well. So I got to see you 2 weeks in a row, and it was just like, it was the best surprise ever.
It was so pumped.
Yes.
I did feel sadness in my heart when you got ripped away from me.
Yes.
And
we switched. We passed each other like ships in the night. Like, yes. I went to SmackDown, you went to Raw, and it was just, I waved to you from Friday night. No. Oh my goodness. Yeah, and then the draft does things to groups. It's a rough time for factions sometimes during the draft.
It's painful.
It hurts. Like, I don't know that people, like, it's obviously like sentimental and like with being such close friends and constantly being around each other and being able to share these moments and stuff. Like, you have a friend that is literally going through the exact same thing that you're going through, mm-hmm. because you're in this group together. And then like you realize like, oh no, like, you know, now I'm on my own, or like even like I'm without, you know, just an integral part of the group. Like, it's scary to like think about the next step of where this is going, or if the New Day or the Riott Squad or anything will ever be together again. It's a terrifying thought. And it was so unexpected. We were so sure that we were supposed to stay together in the draft and that we would stay together. And then all of a sudden it was just so quick that like our entire lives were turned entirely upside down. And I don't know that people really realize like the gravity of that. And I think especially with like you guys, it's everything that in that ring, like the reactions and the real like oh my god, when you're like say his name, like I legitimately, my heart was just torn apart for you, because that was so it was such an organic like reaction of just like, please, like keep us together. And it just it's hard, that whole thing. It's just hard, and I don't think people see it on screen, but they don't realize how much it really does change everything about like your day-to-day life.
It's so wild.
Yeah.
It's so wild.
Yeah, for sure.
Oh, I'm like starting to like feel it.
Again. No, 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 like, no. I don't want to make you feel sad. I don't want to make you feel
no,
sad.
No, no, not at all. Not at all. Well, we're playing Streets of Rage 4. We're super excited.
Yes.
But just something that I think is fun, especially because you get to fight a lot of people who I would say, you know, have like a little bit of a punk vibe to them.
Love it. I've never played this game before, but I like Carrie. I like her.
So excited.
I like her.
So excited for you. And so before we got on, we were talking about punk rock music, because in the previous episode, which everyone needs to go back and watch,
please do.
We both realized that we have apparently been secret best friends for our entire lives.
Just destined to be best friends. Like,
it's so real.
Just, it's written in the stars at this point.
And which brings me actually to my first point. I have changed my mind on what I was going to talk about first. I need you to see what I have here next to me. Does this look familiar at all?
Stop it. What?
This.
No, it's... It's this real. That's real. That's the real. Oh my.
This is what the collection, the collector series is in. They put the entire series inside the Book of Shadows for Charmed.
I genuinely thought that this was like, because I remember we talked about this last time, and you said that the DVD case is the Book of Shadows as well. So I was anticipating when you opened that for there to be DVDs inside, but I did not anticipate there to be the actual Book of Shadows.
Oh yeah, if they mixed
inside
it.
There.
Yeah.
Oh my god, where did you get that?
the internet somewhere. I realized, like, because you know, you get to a point where you're like, these are things that I love, and I don't have them in the capacity that I wish that I had them.
Of course.
And as I was looking, I was like, hold on. There's like a regular complete series set, and then there's like the Book of Shadows complete series set. And I was like, well, clearly there's only one option.
Don't know how you get your hands on some of these things. Like, I am genuinely, this is a talent that you have. Like, I'm genuinely baffled at your ability to obtain some of the coolest collector's items just in the world. The amount of Golden Girls memorabilia that you have is just, I'm so envious. I've never been so jealous of another human being in my life.
Well, you have to come to Atlanta so you can see the shrine.
Yes, please. Back there. I would love that. I would love that so much. Like, I got a little thing in my other house in Indiana. Like, I've got like a little like glass case that has all my Golden Girls stuff in it, but not even close to touching the amazingness that is your like shrine, and you like, you got them painted on your walls and stuff. Like, it's so good, dude. It's so good.
Well, if I like something, I put yeah, as much effort towards it as I possibly can.
Okay. Oh,
sorry. I didn't mean to.
We are off to a great start. I am on your team. Come on.
This is how we treat our guests.
Dang, from the get-go, just trying to see if I'm awake.
That's it.
Man.
Testing your skills.
Yeah.
Nope. Before we started recording, yes, we were talking about the fact that we've never talked about your love for punk rock music.
Yeah.
Or I don't know.
Yours.
I don't know why.
Or yours. That's my biggest surprise, is I didn't know that you liked punk.
I started getting into them when I heard Alec Eiffel by the Pixies, and I was like, excuse me?
Yes, there's so much good stuff like out there, and there's so many different genres of punk that are like, there's something for everyone. Mm-hmm. And that's the best part. Like, some people just think punk is just like this like angry, you know, like sounding stuff, but there's ska, and there's pop punk, there's all kinds of stuff that you can like dabble into depending on what your preference is.
Would Jimmy Eat World count as pop punk?
I think it depends on who you talk to, but I would say so. To me that would be my, but I don't know. I get very nervous sometimes depending on who I'm talking to about talking about punk rock, because I feel like while like the punk rock community is like some of it are like the least judgmental people that you'll ever meet, sometimes when you talk about punk, people are like kind of judgmental about how much you know about punk and stuff like that. So I have always gone with the Sami Zayn approach to it, is I'm not necessarily a punk. I'm a professional wrestler who loves punk rock. Like, okay. I if like you label yourself a punk, there's like hierarchies to it and stuff that make me nervous, and I'm just like, nope, I just like the music. That's all. That's it.
I don't want this stress. I don't need these problems.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
But it's a safe bet to say that Danzig is pretty popular in punk music culture.
He is. Oh, I'm punching you. Okay, I got you back. That was your receipt.
Yeah. Oh, when you press that button, so that's like a big attack if people are surrounding you. But
wow. I don't know what that was.
Yeah, but it's fine. You'll get it back.
Okay.
But when you press Y, see how your health is kind of green in one part?
Yeah.
That attack will take some of your health, but if you attack people before they can hit you, you'll get that health back. But if not, you lose that health. So that's like the gamble.
Got it.
There you go.
Yes. So, Danzig.
Yes.
Legit the single like coolest dude. He's so nice. And I know that he sometimes has had a reputation where people would, you know, argue that point. But as far as to me, he's always been very, very nice and very, very cool. The first time I ever met him, I did not know he was a wrestling fan at all. Or that like a good portion of the Misfits are wrestling fans.
Yeah.
But the first time we met him, we were in the locker room, and Jen from catering comes into the locker room and says to me and Sarah, hey, Glenn Danzig wants to meet you. And we just looked at each other and we're like, what? Like, it just seemed like somebody's messing with us right now. Like, somebody is for sure messing with us. Yeah. And we're, like, walking the whole way, like, ready for somebody to, like, play a joke on us or something like that. But lo and behold, this man is just standing and catering. And I was like, Sarah and I are, like, stood there, like, speechless, completely speechless.
Yeah.
And we walk up to him. We're like, oh, hey, how are you? Like, he's like, oh, yeah, the Riott Squad. He's like, I love you guys, man. Like, it's so cool to see, like, women doing, like, punk rock stuff. And, you know, you guys are a bunch of scumbags, man. And I was like, yeah, we are. Like, it was the nicest compliment I have ever gotten from me. I was like, yes, Glenn Danzig thinks we're scumbags. Like, yeah. It was the coolest thing. And so I think it was sometime last year, I went to a concert. It was like the Misfits reunion concert in Chicago. Oh, ow.
If you get that turkey, you can get health at the bottom. Well, you're full now, but later.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We went to the concert, and like some of the guys that do our setup and stuff, a lot of the guys that work on like setting everything up and whatever, they hooked me up with like tickets and stuff, and we went to the show. The show was incredible. I've actually never seen them live.
Really?
And it was an amazing thing. It was in Chicago. The energy was awesome. We were all just like screaming and singing songs and having a great time. It was just probably one of the best concerts I've ever been to. And they were like, yeah, well, come on to the back. They want to see you. And I'm like, that's crazy to me. That's wild. That doesn't make any sense. And so we went to the back, and the first thing that happens is Jiri only like just starts dancing with me and starts singing. He's like, Ruby, and is like dancing with me, and I'm like, this doesn't even make sense in my brain. It's happening. And then it was right after the draft, and we went into Glenn's dressing room, and he was like, they broke you guys up, man. And I was like, yeah. That's crap. I hate that. And I was like, right, go tell them. Like, go tell them. You might be able to convince them to overturn this decision. And whatever. And he was just so nice. And then I was introduced to Doyle, who is a very large, jacked, like, tall dude, very nice guy. But the first thing they said is, like, this is Ruby. She works for WWE. And he's like, he looks at me and he goes, man, I hate wrestling. And I was like, yeah, man, me too. Because, like, when somebody that large and jacked and intimidating says they hate something, like, you hate it too. Immediately. But, yeah, they were just so cool and so nice. And it was an amazing experience. Just surreal sometimes to just realize that these people that you've, like, idolized for the majority of your life have, like, are fans of yours. It's crazy to me that that's ever a thing. It was just very cool. Like, the, just meeting them in general was just awesome.
Yeah, it's crazy to me. So, like, to be able to be in positions like that, in situations where, like you said, people that you've been, like, obsessed with are like, hey, you're so cool.
Yeah.
With stuff like that going on, like, what is little Ruby feel when those things happen?
I need you guys to understand this, and I think you guys have kind of started to realize this, as you know, I've been on your show only once, but it's pretty easy to tell. I am probably one of the most socially awkward people that exists in the world, and so I'm already socially awkward with, like, my friends and, like, people in general that I work with or anything like that. So meeting someone, man.
Sorry. I'm trying to save you.
Meeting people that I admire or that I that I've idolized for a portion of my life is so unbelievably, like, overwhelming to me that my brain just shuts off and I just keep repeating the same phrase over and over again, and it's always, you're so cool. Do you know how cool you are? Because you're just so cool. Like, I can't stop saying it, and that's all the only words that come. Like, I have a million things that I would always want to say or or whatever, but I just can't, that's the word that I keep getting, like the sentence I keep getting out. And eventually they're like, thanks, I appreciate it. Like, they don't. Yeah. At one point in time, they're just like, okay, weird girl, just keep talking to me.
Well, I gotta go.
The same thing happened when I met Joan Jett. Like, that's all I said to her. Like, oh, I have her, okay, this woman tattooed on my arm. Like she is the reason that women in this industry today, like in the punk rock industry, have, like, she's such a, like a, like an icon when it comes, yeah, to that. And so just with her, like, I just kept saying it over and over again, like, you're so cool. Like, do you know how cool you are? Like, you're so cool. It's just, I can't get anything else out. And then I just turn into this, like, shy, awkward little kid. It's just, so yeah, I just revert back into little Ruby, and I just, like, become this awkward, shy little kid. It's the worst, man.
Ugh. But that's another thing that I feel like a lot of people don't really get to see that side of us, mm-hmm, because obviously, like, we're on television and we're, like, these larger than life personalities.
Yeah.
But, like, there's things that really mess us up.
100%.
And so, like, mine was, and I'm sure that I will have many more if I,
yes,
ever get to,
I'm
where
excited
I'm
to
get,
hear this, actually.
So when I first started training, my trainer, I'm glad that I had him, because he taught me, like, hey, if you're in the same locker room with somebody that you admire, like, don't freak out.
Yeah.
Because you're getting, oh, dressed, yeah, in the same locker room, and you want them to respect you in the same way that you respect them.
100%.
It's like, okay, yeah, great lesson. He's like, obviously, show respect, but, like, don't completely, like, turn into butter.
Yeah.
Which, I will say, is very hard to do sometimes.
Impossible.
Like when I finally met Charles Wright, who's Papa Shango, for those, yeah, of you who are unaware, like,
yes,
losing on the inside.
Yeah.
I was 7 years old,
dying
just thinking about, please don't curse me, but I kind of want you to curse me because that'd be really cool.
That would just make my whole life.
Yeah, and having to straight face, hey, how you doing? Very nice to meet you. You know, big fan of your work. Thank you for everything you've done for the industry. Like, and just trying to keep so professional. But there's a show, Jim and the Holograms, mm, from back in the day?
Yes.
Okay, so I love Jim. I have Jim memorabilia, like, mm-hmm, all over, like, my wall over here.
Yeah.
And I got to meet the voice actress of Jim at, like, San Diego Comic Con one time.
Uh-huh.
So I'm already, like, on cloud nine. I'm, yeah, freaking out, losing my mind. She's so nice to me. She gives me, like, signed picture or whatever. And then later that day, some of my friends are like, hey, there's, like, a Cartoon Network party going down at this place.
That
and
sounds
the
like
people...
That sounds like the best party ever.
Oh, right? And they're like, yeah, the people who work on, some people who work on Steven Universe are gonna be here. Are you familiar with Steven Universe?
I feel like I've heard of it before, but, like, yeah. I can't say that I'm familiar too much.
This show, I will say, it's probably, to me, probably the best cartoon ever made.
What? Whoa.
Purely,
coming,
yeah,
from you, that is a huge deal.
Yeah. For multiple reasons, but mainly because they do a very good job in creating a show, an experience where kids are able to see and understand different people, mm-hmm, that might not be so well respected all of the time.
Okay.
And it normalizes, like, relationships that people try to take a dump on sometimes, just to show people, like, no, all of this stuff is natural and fine and okay, and you don't need to be mean to people. You need to be accepting,
yeah,
of people from all cultures and ways of life. Like,
of course.
It does that without ever really saying it.
Wow.
And it's a very powerful, very,
yeah,
well done cartoon. Just preaches equality at all times, you know?
Love that.
So just,
I love that.
It's really good. And so, the maker of the show, the creator, her name is Rebecca Sugar.
Okay.
And obviously, so to me, she's like the goddess of all goddesses.
Uh-huh, of course.
I'm trying to get into this.
The most amazing show that has the most powerful message,
yeah,
without actually saying it. Like, that's such a talent.
Yeah. And so we're standing outside, like, about to, like, go into this place where the party is. And right before we decide to leave, because, like, oh, like, it's like a pizza parlor or something. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the restaurant's at capacity.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, cool. We'll go somewhere else and do something. Somebody comes out. Yeah, it's okay.
Right.
More receipts.
Yeah.
Somebody comes out, and it's one of the people who does, like, sound design on the, uh-huh, show. And I talked to them on Twitter before. So we talked for a minute. And then, like, 5 minutes into the conversation, they go, oh, I think somebody wants to meet you. And they point, and I turn around, and I'm maybe a foot from Rebecca Sugar. And she's standing there looking at me. And I wasn't ready, you know?
Right.
And I just started weeping.
I love that.
I just legit started crying.
I love that so, I don't like that you're crying, but like, I just love that pure reaction. Oh.
It was so much. And she just hugged me and she's like, hey, it's nice to meet you. And like, she was so nice. I'm going to cry thinking about it right now.
Oh my gosh.
But I just lost it because I wasn't ready. And
right,
I already met somebody.
Of course, you don't have like emotionally prepared for something like that.
Yeah. So I completely feel you on freaking out about Danzig and all them, because it's a lot.
No, for sure. Well, Joan Jett, I had the same reaction, but it wasn't like, because I had a couple minutes to prepare.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I was like, not a lot of people got a chance to meet her. It was WrestleMania. It was the day of. I was told that I may be able to. But I knew that day is so busy already that like, the thought of it, I'm like, yeah, it probably isn't going to happen, you know, whatever. Yeah. And then somebody just grabs me. It's like, okay, we're going to take you to meet Joan Jett now. And like, I had like a few minutes to die a little bit inside and then be like, okay, no, just keep yourself together. Keep yourself together. You're going to be fine. You're going to be fine. And so I get in there, I tell her how cool she is for like 5 minutes. And like, she talks to me a little bit and I'm like, and they give me like a little like goodie bag full of like Joan Jett merchandise. And
what?
I was like, oh, and like, she's just so kind and so like gentle. And it's also crazy to see like somebody who like creates such like powerful music. And it's just like, she's just like this, like kind of like a soft spoken woman that is just like, oh my gosh, I would have never like pictured this, but you're still just so like poised and whatever. And so her dressing room was right outside of where the a lot of the legends were watching the show. So like, I don't even remember who was in there at the time, but like, there was a bunch of legends outside of her dressing room, but I had I was so overwhelmed with how much I felt in that moment and like keeping it together for so long without like freaking out that I just broke afterwards. And so I got out and I like kind of hit the ground a little bit and like started to cry a little bit in front of all of these like wrestling legends and stuff. I'm legitimately sobbing after meeting a woman and like, I don't remember who it was that came up to me and she was like, it'll be okay. And I'm like, she's just like, she's so cool. And she's just
really
like my hero and she's just really important. But and it was just like, I will never forget that moment of like, I'm pretty sure this entire room full of people are looking at me like I am insane. And these are also people I respect, but I just can't keep it together for another second. Another second, just started bawling because she was just so, just an icon. I never in my lifetime did I ever feel like that would ever be a possibility to meet her.
It's so funny because obviously like someone who is so well respected in that field probably has like 9 million stories like that.
Oh yeah, for sure.
And I just, it's so crazy to me like how someone can affect so many people in a positive way just 100%. To be like, because I feel like the average person is like, okay, if you do something like really cool, there might be like a couple people who's like, yeah, you know, you're the best at this.
Yeah.
But like, to have like an entire like world of people who is like, you're the greatest.
Yeah.
But, like, what is that like?
Right. But on the flip side though, like if you think about it, it's crazy. And I've only experienced this a handful of times, but I have had like, especially like WrestleMania week or something, when we have fans from, you know, all over the country and all over the world come in and like meet us like at our meet and greets. And I'm sure you guys have had this happen, you know, a million times or more, is when they come up to you and like fans come up to you and have the same reaction that you have for someone else, like for you. It doesn't compute in my brain.
No, like we've had, it confuses me.
We had this little girl, like I think it was like 2 years ago, we had this little girl that just like, she had a Riott Squad shirt on and it was me and Liv, and like she just started bawling the moment that she met us. And like, my brain does not like understand how to handle that. Not necessarily because it's a bad thing, but it's just like, I don't know if I hope I can live up to how cool I am in your brain.
Yeah.
When you meet me, like I hope I'm as cool like as you built me up to be. And it's just like, it's like, and I'm just like a small, like in my brain, I'm just like this small town girl from Indiana. Like, why are you crying when you meet me? Like, I don't understand. You know what I mean? Like, I can't, it blows my mind that like when that happens with us, you know?
It's like, you hit the nail right on the head. It's the weirdest thing. Uh-huh. Like, I mean, obviously like we do what we do because we want to make sure that we can do what we can to represent, you know, people who are similar to us in this space so they can have somebody that's like in there for them that shows them like, yeah, I can achieve these things too.
Absolutely.
So to have people like actually like tapping into that and seeing that it's like working and doing something, very humbling experience.
1,000%.
I'm completely with you in the fact that like, yeah, when I see stuff like that, like, no, I'm a random dude who grew up in like Marietta, Georgia, who just wanted to wrestle.
Yeah.
And like, we go to Tokyo and there's kids who like know our names. It's like, this is, it's surreal.
Wild.
It's surreal.
Yeah, 100%.
And I think it's important for those people to know like,
yeah,
there are people like we are the same exact way.
Yes.
We just happen to be wrestling on TV.
Yeah, 100%.
We are the same exact way.
Yeah, we are and that's one of the things too that like, I have always kind of, I've never really hidden the fact that I'm, you know, as socially awkward as I am, especially, you know, with my channel, you can definitely see it. Yeah. And I think that's one of my favorite parts. Did you just give that dude a German?
German.
You're so strong. But I think it, like one of the things that I've always wanted to portray is to be approachable and for people to realize like, because like I think with young kids especially, you know, they have these expectations of what they think that their hero is like. Like they what they think they're always super composed, they're always super like socially like cool and stuff like that. And I just like I always want people to know that, you know, I'm awkward and I am uncomfortable sometimes and I don't always know how to have a normal conversation with people and it's okay because that's just me. You know what I mean? Like I am a human being and I'm the exact same, you know, like, and I just like, I think it's just very, like, just very important to like, to show kids, especially that like, to put those expectations on yourself, to be like this image that you've created of your hero is worse than any, this like one of the worst things that you can do is just because it's not a real, it's like not an attainable goal because this person doesn't exist. You know, if that makes sense. I don't know if I'm saying it correctly.
No, definitely. But there's somebody told me something. They met their favorite actor at like a party and they were an actor themselves and they were like just on the come up and they told them, hey, you know, you're my favorite actor. I hope to be as good as you one day. And he goes, you never will be. And he's like, wait, what? Why? And he goes, because you're putting me on a pedestal that's higher than you ever will be. You can't do that. You can't do that. He's like, I know that you're like a fan, but to say those things and to do that to yourself puts me in an unattainable place that no human can reach.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I feel that same way. Like we talked a little bit about this when we did that no makeup photo shoot we did sometime last year.
Yeah.
We did that same thing where like young girls are like trying to be Instagram filters, essentially. Like they're trying to look like their celebrities do when they, like, you know what I mean, when they have full face of makeup and they have, and like they have filters on and like this is not a person that exists. We all wake up with like crusties in our eyes, crazy hair, you know, no makeup. Like we all wake up like that and like, you know, like I said, that's what I think, one of the things I loved about that shoot too is just like to show them like this is how we look without makeup and it's okay, like it's cool. But it's just like that unattainable goal that I think kids, especially with social media, sometimes they put that pressure on themselves and that is just not reachable. And so I think it's very important for us too to be like, we're nerds, we're awkward, and it's okay.
Just that you are fine the way you are.
Yep, exactly the way
you
are.
Fine the way you are. You said you talked about this stuff, or you could see your awkwardness on your YouTube channel. Can you talk about that a little bit for people that don't know?
So I have a YouTube channel. It is called Hooligans Unite, and I started it a few months ago. I am also technologically challenged, so it has been a learning experience for me because I edit all my own videos. I film like all of my content and everything a lot of times here at home. And most of my videos are just like me trying things that I've never tried before. My first video that I made, I interviewed a couple people, but my first video that I made myself was me trying to make a rainbow cake from scratch. and that went horribly.
Wait, do you cook? Do you bake?
I do not. I am very, very bad at baking, cooking, just all of it in general. So I made this like 7-layer rainbow cake from scratch. Well, worst, I start off very poorly because the recipe called for buttermilk and I didn't have buttermilk. But I didn't want to leave my house.
Go get it?
I didn't want to go. I didn't want to leave my house. I was already all set up. I was already ready to go.
Also, can I bring it back a second? So like, I feel like there's different skill levels to things. Yep. So you said a 7-layer rather than just making like a regular cake. You were like,
it was a rainbow. It was a rainbow cake. So you had to have all the colors of the layers when you cut into it. Mm-hmm. And you know, the recipe didn't look too hard, even though it was like 3 pages long, but I was like, this is doable or something. But like the very beginning, I just realized I didn't get buttermilk and I was like, crap. So I looked up appropriate substitutions for buttermilk, and one of the things was sour cream and milk, which is not appropriate substitution.
Also, not for anything.
Also, it required parchment paper, which I didn't get, and I got I had foil, so I used foil instead of parchment paper on this cake. It turned out really bad. I've also done like. So like food hacks, like stuff like experiments and stuff that you've seen, like where you plug your phone into an onion that's been soaked in Powerade or whatever, like whether or not that'll charge your phone.
Did it work?
It did not. But okay. I did a bunch of those. So it's just a lot of things that I've like never done before. Like a little bit of a sneak peek into my life. There's a lot of stuff with my dogs on it. There's a lot of it. It shows just how much I baked a cake for my dog on one of them. A birthday
was that
cake.
A 7-layer cake as well?
That was just a 1-layer cake, but you know what? Okay. That cake turned out way better than my actual human food cake. So
did you make a specific cake for a dog?
Yes, a dog food cake for his birthday. It was Hoovy's fourth birthday. And I baked him a cake out of dog food and peanut butter and bananas and all kinds, and it turned out so well, and I was almost mad about it. I was like angry that I could bake for a dog way better than I could ever do for people. So it's a lot of that. I got the name from my favorite punk band, speaking of, is Rancid, and their album was called Hooligans United.
Yeah.
And so I named it Hooligans Unite because it was like, kind of like, the people I wanted to attract were just like people who were just hooligans. We like to just have a lot of fun and you know, try some cool stuff and support each other and all that stuff. And I definitely wanted to use my platform for good and like to be doing like a have a positive influence on the world, and we haven't been able to, obviously. Where are we? Oh my goodness.
Oh my god, I didn't know that this was a thing.
What is this? So
this is from Streets of Rage 2, I believe.
That looks like Blanca.
This is very much a throwback
to
the things. I forgot that these things were in there, but I've never done this one before.
Yeah, so I started, so what I wanted to do, like, because we haven't been able to, like, really connect with our fans that much, like, personally, so I wanted to still be able to do that and still be able to, like, create, like, some kind of positive thing, so we do what I call the Pay Your Dues raffle. Mm-hmm. I have also been dabbling a little bit in painting. So basically, we have a couple Hooligans Unite t-shirts, which you have seen one of them because I made sure that I gave the biggest Golden Girls fan I know this t-shirt that I designed. And so we have that, some signed 8x10s and stuff, and painting. And so for every $20 that you donate to the fundraiser of the month, depending on what month, we do a 4-week-long fundraiser. And if you donate, for every $20 you donate, you have a chance to win You're entered into the raffle, and then at the end of the month, we draw for the raffle, and whoever wins, if you donate $100 or more, you get all of the prizes. If you donate $20, you get a choice between a shirt and an 8x10 or the painting that I had painted that, you know, that does some, has something to do with the charity that we've done. So
did I see you did one of Chucky Fencer and Tommy Pickles?
Yes. We did a fundraiser for St. Jude Children's Hospital. Mm-hmm. And I wanted something that, you know, that I could try to challenge myself with painting wise, but also that, you know, applied to the fundraiser. And
yeah,
it was my favorite cartoon growing up, you know, one of my favorites. And I really liked that one. I really liked how that one turned out.
Yeah.
But yeah, so I've been very excited to say that we've raised at a minimum of at least $2,000 each month for each charity. So,
nice.
But like, honestly, I can't say enough about how great the people that have followed the channel so far. Like, I have such a great group of people. Like, I look on comments and stuff, and like from like the feedback, and they're just amazing, like positive people that are like empowering each other. And like, I don't know. I just like with the channel, I feel like we have drawn such a great fan base of people, like just like good quality people that are just like positive and nice, and like, I don't know, it just, I'm very excited about how everything's turned out, and hoping that that we're gonna be able to continue to just do some good and
yeah,
fun,
especially like in these times, to be able to do things that fulfill your or satiate your creativity and kind of let you branch out and do things. Mm-hmm. I feel like in one hand it's therapeutic, especially for now.
Uh-huh.
But then I think it's also therapeutic for people that are watching, because they get to again continue to interact and connect with people that they enjoy. Mm-hmm. and see them in this different light.
Yeah.
Plugging your phone into an onion.
Yeah, exactly. It's silly stuff, but it's all stuff like, it's stuff that I have never tried before. Like this last one,
yeah,
my very most recent one that I just did was, I did Halloween makeup, like special effects makeup,
yeah,
as Sally from Nightmare Before Christmas.
Oh, I love Nightmare Before Christmas.
Yes, it's incredible. Probably one of my favorite, Halloween / Christmas movies. It's my entire, it's actually my entire decor for Christmas.
Stop it.
My whole house is decked out in Nightmare Before Christmas, because I'm not a huge Christmas person, but I mm-hmm. love Nightmare Before Christmas. So it's like my way of kind of cheating. And I love Halloween. So it's like my kind of way of cheating out of decorating for Christmas.
So do you dress your dogs up like ghosts and call them Zero?
So I think I'm trying to remember what I was deciding, because I know that I'm in stuff that's hurting me.
Yeah.
But I had an idea for what to put, because they'll probably be the only ones in costumes this year. I'm not 100% sure, but I have
what?
Definitely dressed them up. I've definitely I want to dress up, but I just don't know. I don't know. Like I'm not going anywhere. Like I'm not really doing anything. So I don't know if I'm gonna dress up.
Get on.
Like,
get on IG Live or something?
Maybe, but I think the Sally was definitely like my version of dressing up, because that took me like four hours to do.
Oh, jeez.
It took me so long, but I was very, very happy with how it turned out.
Yeah.
But
do you have experience doing makeup like that, or is that a first as well? Okay.
No, that's a first. Sorry, got distracted.
You're okay. But, if you hit A or B on that turkey, you'll pick it up. But it's green, so it might be.
Got it. There we go.
No, you're good. Okay.
But yeah, not even a little bit. I barely know how to do my own makeup, let alone special effects makeup. So, I was very excited about how it turned out. It wasn't nearly as good as like the tutorial that I did, but, I, like I said, I was very happy with the results of it. But it's just like I said, that's what I wanted to do, is to just try a bunch of things that I've never tried before, and like kind of take people on that journey with me of like, especially to like going back to what we were talking about, you know, like the unrealistic expectations is like, you know, not every like professional athlete is automatically good at everything. You know what I mean? Like I can try to bake and I'm really bad at it, but I'm okay with being bad at it, because I don't have any experience in it. Like,
exactly.
I can show that like there are things that I'm good at and there are things that I'm just not good at. And both of those things, like I just take people with me to try stuff and to, you know, and to see, how the journey is. Like, it's just to embrace the journey, you know?
Yeah. It's I think people like seeing the advancement. Cause like, so you make the 7-layer cake. Yeah. So let's say that in 6 months you go, okay, I'm going to try to make this cake again.
Yep.
Now it's a little bit better. Mm-hmm. And then in 6 months you go, hey, yeah. I'm going to make the second, this 7-layer yeah. cake. And it's a little bit better.
Yeah, and it's actually edible, you know, that yeah. would be, that's the idea. Yeah. I took a bite of that thing. Oh my God. I took a bite of that thing and it was the most disgusting thing I've ever eaten in my life. It was so salty and it was just not, it was like not cooked all the way and it was disgusting. It was so gross.
Well, I would imagine like the sour cream and whatever you said yeah, you put in there just, didn't help too
it
much.
It did not at all. That foil was just a recipe for disaster, I tell you.
Yeah.
I was like, it was made with love, you guys. I just want you to know it. It didn't come out great, but it was made with love.
Yeah. But I guarantee you that if you keep doing things that you haven't done before, like eventually you're gonna be like, hey, well, I suck at this, but I really enjoy it.
Yeah.
And then there's a new skill that you have in like 6 or 8 months.
Yeah.
And then in 2 years, someone goes, hey, we need someone to do this. And you go, oh, I know how to do that.
Exactly, exactly. Like that. And it's also like right now is, you know, is a time where I'm home quite a bit. Like I had to rent a house down in Orlando. My cousin who lives with me is expecting, and she also has asthma. So I just to be safe and everything, I've rented a place down here so that you know I'm not traveling as much back and forth, so that I can come to work, and so I've kind of just been here with the pups quite a bit when I'm not you know at the Thunderdome, so. So it's just kind of giving me like some things that like I never, you know, for a while it was just my only thing was that I loved wrestling. Like that was kind of, you know, what I was like, but I feel like I could be so much more than that. So like, I just wanted to take this channel as an opportunity to just like try new things and to experience new things. And, you know, I think when, you know, things I'm going to be able to even like open that up once everything, you know, is opening back up and things are, you know, safer and stuff. I'll be able to even expand that even more when I can go places and visit things and you know, stuff like that. So it's been very cool. It's been a lot of fun. And like I said, the fans that we've attracted with the channel are just like, just the most positive and awesome people. I think they're just a bunch of punk hooligans that want to watch somebody make a fool out of themselves. So come to my channel if that's what you want to see.
That's all we really want in life. I should just give me a pile driver. Okay.
Oh, dang, girl.
My God.
Good on you. Don't pile drive my friend.
All right, so with your love of punk music and all of the new things that you're trying to do, do you know how to play any instruments?
Oh gosh, I want to learn how to play guitar so bad. So I think that's going to be my next, especially with how cool this girl is with her guitar. Like I definitely want to try. I've had it in my like, I've had like just an acoustic guitar in my Amazon cart for like 6 months, and I just haven't pulled the trigger on it because I think I'm nervous. I played the flute when I was like in high school and probably middle school, closer to middle school. Other than that, I do not, and I couldn't tell you how to play that either, but I do not know how to play any instruments. Actually, I have also always wanted to ask you, do you know like specific songs on the, aside from the New Day Rocks, on the trombone?
Oh yeah, so I played trombone since sixth grade.
Really?
It would take me a minute to like relearn like what I knew, but like I was in symphonic band and like our high school played in Carnegie Hall.
Like, wow, that's huge.
We're like real good. Dang. Well, there was like it was like a big high school invitational thing, and I think we had like one whatever thing in Georgia to get off the opportunity to get invited. So it wasn't like our thing. There was like 300 schools got to play.
But still like 300 out of just like the world is awesome.
It was insane. So like, so I was okay. And I was in like jazz band for a little while and stuff. So I definitely don't remember all of the things that I wish that I did. Cause I didn't play for real for so long. But at one point in life, I'll say it, I was nasty.
Okay, I'll say it. He said, I was nasty.
Yeah. Your boy got that slide work, you know?
Got it. I'm not going to lie to you. I was like, I feel like that nasty is a good thing, the way he's saying it, but I don't, I'm not good with some terms, so I'm just going to kind of wait for him to tell me whether or not nasty is a good thing.
Yeah, once I get some more context, I'll respond to this.
I have to do that sometimes, especially like my cousin is younger than me, and also Liv is very well versed in things, so I've had to like ask people what things mean, but I'll like take them to the side and whisper it afterwards. Like one time my cousin told me, like, she was like, at me next time, and I was like, I don't know what that means. And I was like, Lexi, what does that mean? And she was like, you know, that means like mention me next time, like just like if you're gonna talk about me, say it about me. Yeah. And I was like, oh, why don't you just say that?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, but I'm just so behind with things like that, I don't know what a lot of things mean.
So you know who, like, so the relationship between you and Liv is essentially the relationship that I have
with who? I'm sorry, you cut out.
With Tyler Breeze.
Oh, perfect. Yep, that's exactly what it is. 100%.
So, because I can't tell you how many times he's come to me and be like, we're like rap lyrics, be like, hey, what does this mean?
Yeah.
And then once he knows, then he'll say it to everybody.
I feel like this happens to me all the time. Like, this happened to me recently, I want to say, where I was like everybody around me knew what it meant and I did not. And I just had to be like, what does this mean?
Just eat it.
Yeah. What does this mean? Yeah, she knows everything. Like, she's so, like, for lack of a better term, and the old person term, she's so hip. She's so hip with the times.
You're not like 80.
No, but I just don't. I don't know why. I just have never like caught on, and I feel like every time I catch on, I'm like behind. You know what I mean? Like if I start to say something, they're like, oh my gosh, that's so, you know, 6 months ago, and I was like, but I just learned it. Like, I don't understand.
Like, why is everyone saying new words?
Yeah, I'm just so like one step behind always. The worst.
But it works. You pull it off. You make it work.
That's why I have friends like Liv, where she's so smart when it comes to stuff like that, where she can just help me out, and she can see it in my face when I don't know when things. She can see it, and she'll subtly explain it within the conversation, and I'm like,
she just sees you drowning. Let me give her some context.
Yeah, let me just throw her a life raft because she's definitely drowning.
Oh, well, is there anything else that you've got going on that we haven't talked about that you want to make sure people know?
Like I said, if you want to check out like the app, it's at Unite Hooligans on Instagram and Twitter. And then it kind of gives you the ways to donate to our organizations for the month. This particular month of October, we are doing Hooligans Help, the Breast Cancer Research Foundation. And so like it gives you it to each attached to each video is what is the link to donate. So aside from that, that's really kind of all I've been doing. It's just that and hanging out with my dogs, you know, the usual, nothing else too exciting, but. And being on Up, Up, Down, Down, that's pretty much the best part of my week so far.
Oh, well, thanks. Yeah. We're glad that you're on.
For sure.
Because as soon as you came to me and you were like, hey, do you know any good, like, oh, here, ask the people. So she approached me a while ago and said, hey, do you know any good, like, platformers on Steam?
Yes, platformers / puzzle platformers.
Yes.
I do love puzzle platformers, and platformers are my main game that, like, I will play on my own. Like, if you know, like, I really, really like puzzle platformers these days. Like, I'm very much excited about Little Nightmares 2. I'm very, very excited about the release of that because I don't really like to be scared, but that one's good. You know what game is the worst, by the way, and it is kind of a puzzle platformer game that I can't do it. My anxiety won't let me. Is Hello Neighbor.
Oh, really?
Have you played that game?
I did a little bit, but I didn't get like deep into it.
If you get, especially if you get it to where like the volume is loud enough or you're like wearing headphones, basically when you get close to the dude or the dude sees you, it makes this horrible like it's like Jaws.
I don't like that.
But worse, where it gets like where you can like hear your heartbeat where it's getting closer to you. It's the it, like, my anxiety can't handle it. I'm like, I don't like this at all. I don't. It's too much, man. So, yeah. But like, yeah. If anybody, like, yeah, tag me on Twitter or whatever. If you guys got recommendations, I am all for them, because I have been doing a lot of gaming lately, and I'm all about it.
Now go ahead and at her.
Yes, at me next time. But also, that was like my subtle way of also, I definitely wanted your opinion on it, but that was also my subtle way of like working in the fact that I wanted to be a part of UpUpDownDown, and I wanted to, but I didn't want to be that person that's like, I want to ask you, but I don't want to like ask you.
No.
You know?
You're welcome literally anytime you want to be on.
I see you guys having so much fun, like on like Instagram and stuff, and I'm just like, man, I want to be cool like them. But I'm like, I also don't want to be like that person that's like, hey, do you want to have me on here? And you're like, yeah, that'd be great. But like in reality, you're like, God, I don't want you. Like,
do you know Ruby was asking to be on the channel?
She wants to be on the channel. Like, what?
Oh my God!
What a loser, man, nerd.
Never.
But then I'm like, you know, UpUpDownDown, you're so cool. Like, can I be on your channel? Like, that's pretty much what it was. Or I'm like, you got any special platformer games? Also, can I like hang out with you guys? Or no?
It's like, please, we always want people to come to hang out.
I love it. I love this channel. I love everything about, you know, the vibe here, and just like, you guys are always like looking like you have so much fun, and like your Among Us stuff lately has been killing me. Just makes
so
me laugh.
So much fun.
So
we
hard.
Need to get you in playing. I saw you were doing Fall Guys with with the BRE.
I did. I did Fall Guys.
How'd that go for you?
I am not the best at it. And I also, that's where you see video game Ruby come out, which is I get, I'm very vocal when I'm angry.
As you should be.
But it's like, what is this? It's like bad. I get very vocal about like when I'm like, I definitely have to like censor myself. I've been like better about it too, especially with my channel, because I don't like to curse on my channel at all.
Yeah.
Because I don't know how many kids are watching it, but I definitely I've been coming up with new curse words. I'm like, son of a sea biscuit. Like, I've been trying to be better about like coming up with curse words, but like, they definitely come out when I'm playing. Fall Guys is incredibly frustrating.
Rage inducing.
I like Among Us a little bit better, but I'm starting to learn how to get better about it. I've been playing it with some of my friends at home, and I do this thing where I was really bad at being an imposter for a hot minute.
Yeah.
Like when I was the imposter and somebody would like accuse me, and I would just like give in. I'd be like, yeah, you're right. Like, instead of trying to fight it. I definitely did it. And then I would just vote for myself. Like, yeah, not my I'm like so non-confrontational, and I'm like, yeah, okay, whatever you say. For sure, yeah, it's totally me. But I've gotten better about it since I've played a little bit. But Fall Guys is just, it's the most infuriating thing that I've ever played.
Oh my God, yes.
So angry at the BRE for introducing me to this. I'm like, you just set my blood cholesterol level up, just so my blood pressure, not my blood cholesterol.
I was like, my God, it really got you.
My blood pressure up so high. But I would definitely be down to play whenever y'all
want. I want to start a
new setup. Yeah, I got a whole new setup for gaming on the computer. I got a whole new Alienware laptop, like all the whole nine yards, everything.
Yes.
So I'm definitely ready.
Good. We play Uno, dude. It for whatever reason has just become like the staple of quarantine life.
Love
so
it.
It's like it's me, Cole, me, Adam, Cole, and Breeze and Cesaro.
Yes.
But I kind of want
the best group ever, by the way. Like, you guys are so funny together. It makes me laugh so much.
Such a good time. But I'm thinking that I want to start like an Uno league.
Love it.
So if we can get a bunch of people to play and have some games with everybody and try to like crown an Uno champion or something.
So here for it. Oh my gosh, so here for it. Wow.
So when you're saying that you have to make up new curse words, so again, so like I've got a 3-year-old, and so obviously he can talk and he can have a full conversation, but we've always said, oh, fiddlesticks in the house. Yeah. Try to, at least.
Of course.
And so the other day he like stubs toe on something. He goes, I hear him screaming, ah, oh, fiddlesticks! and I was crying laughing. So it's like such a
with the most anger in the world.
Yeah. Like, for all intents and purposes, a hard curse would have been completely, like, acceptable. Man. I mean, not acceptable, but, like, it would have fit
like,
there.
Yeah, okay. With the tone that he said it in, it would definitely sounded like, oh, like he said a curse word, but instead...
He cursed like a grown man and said fiddlesticks. Like, okay, we're good. We're trying new things.
Oh, my gosh. I just pictured just a little mini you just screaming fiddlesticks at the top of his it makes me so happy.
This is the best.
Oh my gosh, that's incredible. Yeah, so I might snag fiddlesticks from it. I've gotten to a point, especially if I'm, because I like one of the times I tried to make rainbow popcorn. That was a hack. That was a hack that I found where you just put Skittles and popcorn kernels in a pan, mm-hmm. and it's supposed to pop like beautifully rainbow popcorn. It's bull.
Like
it's complete bull. It does not work. I'm gonna let you know right now. But I burnt the crap out of my hand on scalding hot Skittles. The most painful experience. And I that was where I broke out Son of a Seabiscuit. Couldn't tell you where that came from. But like a lot of times I'll just like make a noise with it where I'm like, son of a
mm-hmm. It's all that
grunt where I can't, like, I'm like, I want to curse so bad, but I'm not going to poison the youth of America.
Yeah. Something has to come out of your mouth. Like,
I'm definitely regressed to just noises. So I'm definitely going to have to steal fiddlesticks. And I'm going to also, that's another thing. If you would like to tag me in and you have substitutions for curse words that I could maybe grab. So puzzle platformers and substitutions for curse words. At me next time.
That's all the time we have with you.
Yeah.
So, but we made it pretty far through this game.
We did some damage.
It's a good time. And I feel like we learned a lot on the way.
Yes, we did. We most definitely did. Thank you so much for having me on your channel. And I also like one of the things I need you guys to know. One, the last time we did this interview, my mom still talks about it. She still talks about. She's talked about, like, she watches all my stuff. She thinks my YouTube channel, she always calls it a podcast. Mm-hmm. And she tells me all the time that she's going to pray really hard for me to have my own talk show. She's going to pray. She said, if I pray really hard, it'll happen. Like, pray a little hard out, Mom. I appreciate it either way. But she still talks about this interview to this day. And it was, what, like 3 years ago, something like that?
Yeah.
But she loved this one so much. And I think, too, is because we talked about, like, the Golden Girls and stuff like that. But she had so much fun on this. And so, like, I know she's going to love this one so much. So, Mama Rue Rue, if you're watching, love you.
Shout out Mama Rue Rue.
Mama Rue Rue. But,
matter of fact, when you tag Ruby, make sure you hashtag Mama Rue Rue.
Hashtag Mama Rue Rue. She won't understand how to use the hashtag because we're about on the same level. But she, again, I'm a step ahead because I'll call it a YouTube channel and not a podcast.
Yeah.
But I'm so grateful and happy to be here. I still have my Golden Girl shirt that you guys got me last time, and still to this day I still get tagged when people go to the grocery store and they find French Toast Crunch. People will tag me and be like, "Son of Ruby," and I'm like, "Yeah, where are you so I can get some?"
Yes. And also, if Cinnamon Toast Crunch wants to come through with that sponsorship.
Yeah, man. The French
Check her
toast.
Out.
It's not. It's
oh,
not
sorry, sorry, sorry. It's French, the French toast.
French toast.
I always mix them up.
It's French toast. But no, it's great. It's great. So thank you guys again for having me here. And
of course.
I hope to come back to the up, down, down world.
Oh, definitely. Definitely. And where can they find you on socials and what's your YouTube again, just so they can hear it again?
So on socials, at Ruby Riott WWE on Instagram and Twitter. And then I have, it's at Unite Hooligans on Instagram and Twitter. And then Hooligans Unite is my YouTube channel. And then if you want to donate to the fundraiser of the month, all you have to do is go to the most recent video, and then underneath is the link to donate. And for every $20, you get entered into a chance to win a painting that is painted by me, one of a kind, and then or a cool Golden Girls Hooligans Unite shirt that our friend Austin Creed here actually possesses, so you can be as cool as him if you donate to this charity.
Well, that it's the shirt that makes me cool, because I myself am not cool, but the shirt helps.
Don't you ever say that. Don't you ever say that about my friend ever again. You are the single cool, you have a Golden Girls mural on your wall. If that does not, I literally was thinking about it too, and what you have, like, the pictures and stuff that you've posted of, like, your home and, like, all the cool rooms that you have about, like, all the things that you have is, I genuinely feel like it's, like, most kids, or, like, especially, like, 90s kids, it's, like, their dream home. It's, like, what they would picture in their head of, like, this is what my house is gonna look like before, like, I became an adult and, like, felt like I had. But, like, your house is, like, legitimately, like, people's dream home, because it just has so much cool stuff. So don't you ever say that you're not cool, because you're legitimately the single coolest person.
Okay, well, we gotta connect to have you on again soon for something else.
Your other stuff. Thank you guys so much for having me. I always have a blast. Always.
Of course. Thank you so much for being on. And I know that you guys enjoyed this episode, because we nonstop talked, because this is a fantastic conversation. Ruby Riott. Rue Rue is the best. Excuse me. Rue
Rue.
It's the best. So again, thank you for being on. Thank you guys for watching.
Thank you,
make sure, you know what, matter of fact, make sure you're taking clips of this, putting them on socials, adding people, your friends. Yeah, at me next time. So people can come check out the episode and learn more about our dear sweet Rue Rue.
Aw, thank you guys so much for having me. Appreciate it.
Definitely, definitely. You can, you know, you can check me on Instagram and Twitter at Austin Creed Wins. You can check out the channel, Instagram and Twitter, UpUpDownDown without the O's. Like, subscribe, share, all that good stuff. But most importantly, make sure you always and forever keep it tight.
I love when you do that.